Hi, everybody. Nice to see everybody. Welcome. Friends, Geddes Hall is the home of the Institute for Church Life and the Center for Social Concerns. And I'm pleased to be able to recognize members of the Advisory Council here present for the Institute for Church Life and the Center for Social Concerns. So welcome them, as well as the Executive Director of the Center for Social Concerns, Paul Coleman, Father Paul Coleman. Friends, welcome. This is the opening lecture in our fifth season of the series Saturdays with the Saints. Sixth.
We're off to a good start.
Dang. It's the sixth season. Friends, who are the saints? The saints are the ones who stretch our imaginations. They interpret the mysteries of the faith with the medium of their lives. The saints emerge in the church and from the life of the church, but they don't belong to the church alone. They're for all people, for the whole world. Think for a minute of Mother Teresa, whose feast day is today. Mother Teresa inspired the imagination of the U.S. Postal Service. She actually got a stamp. That's pretty good. I'm waiting for mine. The saints are for the whole world because, friends, it says in Scripture, God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. And just as he was light of the world, so the saints, they're like little lights, bearing the reflection of him who is the light. It's one way that he continually helps to illumine our way in a world which, as Mother Teresa herself experienced, can sometimes seem filled with darkness. So, friends, what better way than to spend Saturdays than with the saints? And after all, Saturday is the ancient Sabbath. And in both Jewish and Christian tradition, because it is the day of God's rest, it's an image of the eternal rest of the saints with God. That's an image of heaven. An eternal Saturday with the saints. How's that? And that makes our lecture series a foretaste of heaven, and not many lecture series can claim that. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, blessed be God in his angels and in his saints. Friends, the theme for this season, Saturdays, is saints who spoke up and spoke out, sometimes at the expense of their jobs and even their lives. Our first saint in this series is St. Thomas More, and our first lecturer is Professor Cyril O'Regan, who holds the Catherine Huisking Chair of Systematic Theology in the Department of Theology right here at the University of Notre Dame. Cyril is an internationally renowned theologian who's especially known for his work at the intersection of philosophy and theology. It's not an exaggeration to say that his books and his articles are known anywhere in the world where Catholic theology is done. And as a bonus, the titles of his books are perhaps the best in the business. The recently released Anatomy of Misremembering, a 500-page work on the history of 20th century theology from the perspective of the contribution of Swiss theologian and cardinal in pectore Hans Urs von Balthasar, is a great example. Theology in the Spaces of Apocalyptic, a shorter work of only 120 pages, is another example of a book that one might pick up just to have an explanation for the title. But the truth is, if you do pick it up, you'll be amply rewarded. I guarantee you, you'll read it to the end if you have any interest in theology at all. Speaking of titles, this morning Cyril's lecture is entitled Thomas More, Saint in a Time of Political and Cultural Crisis. Please join me in welcoming Professor Cyril O'Regan.
I thought John had taken my paper, and though I am Irish and I'm sure I can extemporize, I don't intend to this morning. you didn't get a great title, but you got an apt title, and sometimes apt titles are better than the more florid and flowery ones, to which I am accustomed and to which I am pleading guilty. This here gives you a promise I shall not fulfill. If you come for the glorious video show, I'm afraid that, again, my Irishness is going to be used to exculpate me. We're talkers, so you're going to get talk. And lots of it. It comes by the pound. Well, for those of you sort of who are already tired, and it's a long way before the game, so you're reserving your energy, let me just say three things that, in essence, the talk is about. So it gives you the roadmap. I want to say that saints in general, and this saint in particular, is not a fluffy toy or a puppy dog. I like puppy dogs. Saints are challenges, and they are sometimes, if not immediately, ultimately controversial. And more is now controversial. Second, if there is an analogy between what Moore has to put up with and ours, it probably, in our case, is more nearly centered on cultural crisis. Political crises come and go, but they necessarily are going to get resolved or dissolved. Cultural crisis lasts forever. So I think that the analogy between talking about the 16th century and the 21st century, at least in this case, I think is going to move from the political cultural to probably the cultural alone. And last, and this takes up where John left off, I'm going to use the image that John left us with, that is the image of light, that a saint is a form of light. And I suppose what John is saying and what he has said when he introduces the first talk in the series or when he introduces all talks in the series, is that somehow or other, saints light out, shout out, give us some form of instruction by their life as much as by their words. But of course, the shouting out and the lighting out is intended to be a refraction of Christ lighting out or Christ shouting out. So I want you to hold those three things together sort of as I begin my paper, and hopefully that sort of will be, if you like, your hearing glue with respect to what I'm going to say. Let me start with the image. Saints are lights. Lights flash and flare, sometimes in their own time, and sometimes later as what was hidden comes to light. Now, the acceptance of this light is no more automatic than the acceptance of the most effulgent light of all, the light of light who came into the world and shone in the darkness. When John says in the fourth gospel that the world knew him not, he doesn't mean literally that the world didn't know him. He means rather that the world did not judge him properly, place the value on him that it should have. He is in fact saying that the world chose something other than the light, chose a routine in which we remain comfortable, accepted a low ceiling of our individual and social behavior, expecting little and deluding ourselves with respect to the grand spectacle that will momentarily take away the meaninglessness of our lives. And this is darkness. This is what world is in John. Not the kingdom in which we behold beauty bathed in the light of the one who makes all things beautiful. And to read the Gospel of John is to come to appreciate that the world is really and truly beautiful. The saints then are points of light. And because they are so, they are sources of provocation. Perhaps for every 10 persons who admire Mother Teresa, there is but one who hates her. But often the hate is much, much more vehement than the love. The new atheist Hitchens thinks of Mother Teresa as an abomination. Poverty is systemic. It needs a systematic, rational approach to alleviate it. She merely palliates and leaves social injustice intact. She is hateful, quite literally hateful, because so self-serving in her extraordinary sanctity, which society, quite literally, cannot afford. Any number of other examples might be provided. But there is one saint most of us would almost bet on is going to escape this characterization from even Christianity's most implacable foes. And that is the subject of this morning's presentation. The ever reliable, ever non-excessive, and psychologically approachable Thomas More. Canonized 400 years after his execution by Henry VIII, More is a Renaissance figure. Brilliant statesman, extraordinary writer, incisive wit, learned jurist, political reformer, one in whom great expectations were placed on him early only to exceed them all. A glowing figure around whom others circle, a man who manages self-love with as much tact as he can dispense altruism. A man, above all, who skillfully negotiates the narrow straits between his vexed enemies. A man who seems to be able to do the impossible in evoking warmth and respect from the large figure of Henry VIII, who, when More becomes chancellor, is beginning his audition to be a monster. And in passing, it should be said that More was convinced that monsters would always be with us. There are the clever lines about monsters in Utopia, which hover between being literal and metaphors for corrupt and malicious human beings. We did not ask, this is someone who has left the island, which is Utopia, if he had seen any monsters, for monsters had ceased to be news. More is the figure more rather than less rounded than we are, more an aesthete and an ascetic, and certainly a man who can take his pleasures where he finds them and feels entitled to them, in a world that is dangerous and often too short. But the world for all that is so beautiful that it cannot be missed and whose leaving is hard. And most definitely, he is not a man afraid either to associate with or to wield power. Robert Bolts, and for those of you of a certain age, is going to be the reference point. Robert Bolts, The Man for All Seasons, first a play and then a major movie, captures much, if not all, of this. More is indeed a man for all seasons. Bolts is influenced by the statements of one of More's contemporaries, Robert Whittington, who marveled at More's intellectual, moral, and emotional register. Qualities which are contraries in others and in us are harmonized in him. Sharp wit and deep learning don't usually go together, they go together. A sense of self and great gentleness don't usually go together. A marvelous sense of fun and deep gravity usually don't go together, go together. And Bolt translates Whittington's famous phrase about More being a man for all seasons into the idiom of admirable personal integrity. He is a man reliably himself under all circumstances. The summer of his eminence as a chancellor, rather, the spring of his ascent to literary prominence with the writing of Utopia, the summer of his eminence as chancellor, the autumn of his dealing with the Reformation in England, and the winter of his betrayal, the perjury of those close to him in the show trial that leads to a conviction of treason and him losing his head. Now, Bolt's major play is not a construction out of the blue. He follows the history writing of the major writers in the 20th century on the Tudor period. It simply takes the story out of its historical wrappings, and by dramatizing interactions that are either revealing of More's character or definitive in terms of the plot, universalizes the man of conscience who stands up to overwhelming power and whose defeat is for us, the audience, in the movie theater or our homes, paradoxically a victory. Now, this is the standard iconography, and in most respects, it is compelling. More is a humane man of conscience for whom the tensions between loyalties to church and state, or fate and political expediency, is the outer form for what essentially matters, which is the operational conscience about what is right and wrong and one's responsibilities to its deliverance. More, therefore, is not only one of the safer saints, since we can easily identify with him. He is also an individual with whom the modern person can identify without necessarily taking seriously Moore's particular religious commitments. I suppose the best way of lodging a criticism against the play and the movie is to say that Moore is moralized. He is figured as a moral hero with due rectitude. He's not really figured as a saint, which would make little sense to a humane agnostic like Bolt. Bolt cannot imagine a Moore who in his last days configures his life to the passion of Christ, about which Moore wrote so eloquently in his treatise on the Passion and in his salty exchanges with Protestant reformers. I will return to this point as I conclude the reflection. Now remember I said that saints and martyrs, and especially martyr saints, are lights as points of contradiction. There are some of you who have watched the BBC program Wolf Hall. Others of you who perhaps have read the novels of Hilary Mantel on which it is based. And if you have, in either case, you know that both deliberately intend to challenge the standard picture of Moore. Now, there's much that is silly in the picture of a scheming, self-satisfied, and bigoted Moore. There is even more that is preposterous in his favoring Thomas Cromwell, who turns out to be a man full of moral integrity in contrast to Moore, the Renaissance Rome-loving eel, the hater and persecutor of Protestants. Moore is something of a sadist because of his torture of Protestants, but also a masochist since he wears a hair shirt, which even at this early point in modernity is beginning to be pathologized. Nonetheless, despite its own massive anti-Catholic bigotry, one part Reformation to 10 parts Enlightenment stereotyping, perhaps Wolf Hall provides two major services to a picture of the real Moore. First, it raises the question of whether Moore at least connived in the persecution of Protestants. Got a complex figure who may be a sinner as well as a saint. And also whether Moore was sophistical when he claimed that the church condemned wrong thinking and punished no one, and that the state punished heresy for reasons of the state, that is, the connection between heresy and sedition. And two, and more generally, it calls for a thicker description of the life of Moore, a highlighting of the different sides of his character, the affable and the not so affable, as those sides are in tension with each other. But Bolt, and also those who depends on older estimates of Moore, and this revisionist history writing deployed in Wolf Hall, get Moore wrong and get him wrong badly, albeit in different ways. Moore is through and through not only a religious and not simply a moral man, but also a staunch Catholic, who on the one hand believes it possible for Catholics to align faith and reason and religious belief not only with loyalty to, but love of the social world. And on the other hand, is prepared for and knows the hour when the alignment or compromise is no longer possible. Moore is neither radical nor is he a fanatic. He believes in alignment. He believes in compromises. Looking on at a reality in the tone of the Reformation with horror, he believes in the Catholicism of Erasmus. Life is a muddle. And so also, to a certain extent, is the church. Might have a side and let's get used to it. So also is the church. But we live towards God in and through its imperfection. For on Moore's account, this is the only craft that will take us home. He is resolutely Augustinian in this respect, and open like Augustine to dealing with the state, which can be reformed only by working with the power structures rather than having a fascination with clean hands. Let's go back to the beginning. Born in 1478, Moore was almost from the beginning a chosen one. He studied in the preparatory school of St. Anthony's, eventually went to Oxford when he was 14, and there studied Latin and Greek literature. He became proficient and wrote plays, comedies rather than tragedies, which it turns out is actually quite indicative of his character. He left after 2 years at his father's insistence to study law in London. He succeeded in this, as with everything else, although very soon after he became a lawyer, he pondered for a while becoming a monk. A year of experiment later, he realized that a solitary life was not for him. He married and started practicing law, although he always maintained profound respect for monasticism and judged himself, rather than his celibacy and ascetic rigor, for his leaving. Perhaps the earliest sign of his election, the chosen one, was his apprenticeship with Archbishop Morton, Renaissance lover, Archbishop of Canterbury, Chancellor of England, and later Cardinal, whose idea it was to send a precocious Moore to Oxford. Moore, then, was associated with the powerful almost from the beginning. The gifted and energetic Moore made a name for himself almost immediately, translating a work about the even more gifted Italian humanists. It's hard to think that someone's more gifted than Moore, but actually there were a few, called Pico della Mirandola, and exercising a long friendship with Erasmus through personal meeting and by letter. He became a cause célèbre with the publication of Utopia in 1516, published initially with an ingloriously long Latin title that amounted to a short book, and translated into English over 40 years later. The book was the first imaginative construction in the modern period of the perfect society that we could hold up before us as a mirror in and through which we could see the imperfections of our actual society. It was extraordinarily well received, and in fact created a literary genre in that it was quickly followed by other such constructions. Even if the genre was popular for a considerable time, it did have something of an expiration date. Still, utopias in general, and Moore's utopia in particular, continued to inspire even as the interest turned away from what a good society might look like to practical questions of how concretely to execute reform. Of course, the ultimate template for Moore's utopian construction was Plato's Republic, even if the utopia constructed by Moore was significantly more democratic than Plato's ideal state ruled by the philosopher king. The details of the construction are not relevant here. What is important are the values, are the virtues displayed in contrast to the vices which he wants to overcome. Peace, not war. Health, not disease. Justice, not power. Sharing of material goods, not private property, religious tolerance, not persecution, humane criminal system, not a punitive one, plain speaking, not flattery, humility, not pride, self-respect, not vanity. Important also was the conviction that utopia cannot be actualized as a historical reality. In utopia, we find Moore expressing his real views in a brilliant piece of understatement. He writes, "For things will never be perfect until human beings are perfect." And then he adds wryly, "which I don't expect for a number of years." Obviously, this is an expression of the political realism of a Renaissance humanist who thinks it okay to sing the potential greatness of human being, but not to insist on it as a practical matter. The overwhelming body of evidence suggests, for the most part, that human beings, while not vile, are ruled by folly and venality. It's not difficult to think of Moore being a forerunner of the famous 20th century political philosopher Isaiah Berlin, whose anti-utopianism is summed up by an anthropological ruling of its impossibility, indicated in his favorite phrase, the crooked timber of humanity. Still, we should not take religious or Christian convictions out of Moore's construction of us as highly fallible human beings. Moore is through and through Augustinian. We can and should make our societies better. Because of twist and torque, because of some part of us always having already been eaten away, we cannot, however, make them perfect. The perfect society is the society of the blessed. It is elsewhere. Everywhere in our actual society, there are manifestations of sin, of our inability, we might say, not to leave our sweaty palm prints on off everything we touch. Of these manifestations, some are remediable, some are not. Working for those which are is our social and political duty. Moore found himself engaged in dispute with Protestants in the latter part of his life, both before and during his days as chancellor. His defense in 1521 on behalf of the Catholic view of the sacraments, and by implication the Catholic Church that dispensed them, gained Henry VIII the title of Fidei Defensor, Defender of the Faith, since it was he on whose behalf Moore wrote. Another response to Luther followed in 1523. And from 1528 on, Moore was in disputation with Tyndale over Tyndale's translation of the New Testament with his heavily annotated anti-Catholic barbs. Now, none of this polemic makes easy reading. You may have read Utopia and you may have read some other things by Moore, but I think if you read the polemical tracts, there is a certain queasiness that will overcome you. Moore's civility index when it came to Protestants is roughly at the same level as Luther and Tyndale, which is to say, usually bad. The tone vituperative, and totally capable of denying the name of Christianity to each other, and even the basic humanity of its members. A student of Erasmus, who never actually behaves in this way, Moore's tone falls far short of his. Responding to Luther's latrine-oriented remarks about the church, and I'm being somewhat decorous by saying latrine, you could use a few other words, about the church, its ministers, and the Pope, Moore responded in kind, calling Luther potty mouth. Actually, it's much worse than that, but let's say I'm using my indoor voice. And just in case we didn't quite get the barb, he draws out at incredible length its implications. And doing so in Latin, mind you. One might have thought that writing in Latin rather than vernacular would have cut down on this sort of thing. It didn't stop Luther, however, and it didn't stop Moore. It is an illusion that Latin is intrinsically a language of refinement. It's a language which spans all our thoughts, emotions, our loves, both wanton and correct, and our hatreds and our dismissals. Moore was a major reader of the Roman comic artist Lucian, who plays the low registers of our conduct and our mouths. And he put it to good use when rebutting Luther and Tyndale. Although the language is loathsome, it is not as if the issue or issues are trivial. The battle lines drawn between Catholicism and Protestantism are both wide and deep. They concern the number, nature, and definition of the sacraments, the status of papal authority, the nature of priesthood and celibacy, the understanding of marriage, whether we can assist in our own salvation that comes through Christ, or we are justified without having any merits of our own, and finally, the status of Scripture and the role if any, vernacular translations can play, and who is a definitive interpreter, the individual or representatives of the church. There is no yielding on either side, and the rhetoric is not short on demonizing. This comes through loudly also in Moore's condemnation of Tyndale in the late 20s and early 30s. And for the record, Tyndale is equally demonizing the Catholic Church and Moore as its defender. Moore does think that Luther and Tyndale sponsor the presumption that every unlearned person has equal capacity when it comes to making theological judgment. From his point of view, this is not only nonsensical, but socially irresponsible, and puts any nation state in peril, since it's likely to foment civil unrest. This is Moore's reading of what has happened on the continent, and which in his view is being exported to England. The political dimension is very important to Moore. Yet it is not only a matter of politics, it is also for him a matter of truth, and how it can be accessed. He thought that Protestantism was contradictory in affirming the accessibility of Scripture, while at the same time speaking of the total corruption of the intellect charged with reading it. The Catholic position, in his view, was eminently more sensible. There was and is a church and an authoritative tradition to supplement, not displace, our flawed but not entirely opaque and broken intellects. There were limits to the untutored intellect, in his view. And besides, human beings, rational animals though we may be, are not beings of unfettered intellect. They are also, and we are also, creatures of will and desire. We have a will to believe what suits us, and our motivations, often bad, have to be taken into account. Now, this is Moore's translation of Augustine's anthropology, which he thinks, like Erasmus, is the church's anthropology. If there is a fight over Scripture, sacraments, grace, and the church, there's also a fight over Augustine and who has him in their corner. This is one of the marks of the battle between the humanists Erasmus and Luther. It also marks the battle between Moore and Tyndale. Moore cannot imagine a theological tradition without Augustine. Moore has read much of the available corpus, including the Confessions and the City of God. And while he had done considerable reading before his polemics, Augustine becomes a crucial ally in the refutation of the heretics, as he speaks to it. Now, one cannot simply set aside Moore's refutation of heretics because it's inconvenient and it's not very nice, since it represents a sizable proportion, a portion of his corpus, and is somewhere in the vicinity of 2,000 pages. Nor can we ignore the fact that Moore rounded up so-called heretics before he became chancellor and at least interviewed them in his home. I will not put interview in inverted commas. That might be sort of his detractors would do that. But interviewed them in his home. Moore admitted to interrogating Protestants, yet vociferously denied torturing them. There is no contemporary evidence that he did, although the accusation was recycled as a truth in Protestant polemics not long after his death. Unsubstantiated, they remain a centerpiece of the revisionist literature on Moore over the past decades, of which Hilary Mantel makes copious use. The Anglican Declaration of Moore as a saint in 1980 is interesting in any number of respects, but perhaps mainly because I think it would have been impossible had the claim to torture been sustained. Still, there remains the fact the Protestants were executed during the time of Moore's chancellorship. Those who want to besmirch Moore's legacy tend either to exaggerate the number or leave it unspecified. And the best of modern scholarship is able to get at, the number probably is around 6, with about 40 being held and interrogated over the period of 4 years, while Moore was the second most powerful man in England. I think that one can say that in the face of the threat of Protestantism in England, More highly rose above what was worse in the back and forth between Catholicism and Protestantism. He equivocated when he argued that the church does not torture or execute, it is the state, and failed to exercise an intellectual and moral responsibility when he appealed to the extant laws for the persecution of heretics, rather than to the justice he appealed to in Utopia. Third and final section, imperfect man, sinner and saint. More's dealings with the Protestant threat demonstrated that he is not, nor was, a perfect man. He was indeed a sinner. Although nothing he does seemed to disprove that he was not, on the whole, a good man. This is a very good man, much in love with life, which he found both challenging and beautiful. His family life had the benefits of eros, respect, and gratitude. Society provided him with his satisfactions. It recognized More's great knowledge, his quick wit, and power of judgment. And high office had his splendors and his solaces, particularly that by and large, you are comforted by what you believe you are doing good and ameliorating at least, and maybe at a limit, preventing certain evils. And More understood that debt was woven into the pattern of life and wrote about it eloquently in his Dialogues on Comfort in Times of Tribulation, written during the 2 years spent in the Tower of London waiting to die. He accepted the death of his first wife in 1511 and married quickly enough to be the object of gossip. He had no taste for an untimely death and even less interest in a martyr's death. He generalized that what nature insists on is our obligation. We should try to escape death if we can. We can call on everything at our disposal: influence, our intellect, our ability to persuade and argue, our ability to continue to cut and splice and find a middle. In More's case, that he could not take the oath of supremacy, yet he would not speak against it. If we are to die a martyr's death, this has to be God's will, not ours. He grasps clearly that our lives are not our possession. It is God who disposes, and his will is to be accepted. One of the more famous More statements among the many is the following: if he, God, suffers us to fall in such a case that there is no escaping, then we may stand our tackle as best we can. But it is God's part, not our own, to bring us to this extremity. Our natural business lies in escaping. To faint, to splice, to attempt to reconcile the demands of divine and human law, and the laws of the church, interpreted as the vehicle of divine law and the laws of the state, is regarded by More as justified. Indeed, it belongs to the genius of Catholicism, More thinks for better rather than worse, to attempt compromise, to see or to try to see things as coming under something like a both and. More thinks that there is a virtue in such attempted reconciliation that goes beyond the virtue of prudence. The physical and social worlds are in themselves good and beautiful. Despite human sinfulness, they are bathed in the beauty granted them in creation and amplified in and through the incarnation of Christ. Naturally or theologically, justified hatred of the world makes death and especially martyrdom easy. But we cannot hate the world or the structures that contingently make it up. It's not simply bad form. It's unchristian. The genius of compromise, however, is in the end relative rather than absolute. It did not take his own imminent death for More to realize that you have to be very lucky to be able at all times to reconcile duties to God and duties to man, and duties to the church and duties to the state. It is not possible to rule out a moment in which the duties to God or the church and the duties to the state and society will reveal themselves as contraries. And this is the point of decision. The Christian will have to make a choice. However reluctantly, you have to choose one or the other. The singular beauty of the Word of God, or the world with its beauties of the flesh and beauties of speech and rhetoric and their power to persuade and influence. When choice became the only possibility and the only idiom, more choose the higher. The king's good servant, but God's first. He did so hardly without nostalgia for a beauty that is divinely verified. Of course, choice is a matter of conscience. But we're not talking about a free radical. Conscience is tied to deciding when evasion is no longer possible, between being a servant of God or the state, God or the power dynamics of society. Moore is not a moralist, more stoic than Christian, who goes to death in the quintessential English way. Of course, I'm Irish, so I'm going to give this a little jab, with a stiff, with a stiff upper lip. In fact, I was back in the British Isles, maybe a bloated upper lip might be sort of thing. The man who climbs the steps to meet the axe of his executioner is a luminous reader of Thomas A. Kempis's The Imitation of Christ, a book which probably had as much circulation as the Bible for hundreds of years. And an even more luminous reader of the Gospel narratives, Passion narratives, as he demonstrates in the second of the two books, written in the Tower, that is, the sadness of Christ. The Passion narratives reveal all that is essential about death, the longing not to suffer and to surrender the cross that is inbuilt in us as bodily creatures who experience but don't want to experience physical pain. It also discloses the pained affirmation of thy will be done, and into your hands I commend my spirit. More is a point of light, one attended to throughout Catholic history and granted official recognition by the Catholic Church in 1935 and pronounced saint of statesmen by J.P. II in 2000. He was a light of flash and flare, and flared in his own time. It also through the long history of his veneration that continues to do so until this day. His light is not that of a plastic figure, but of a complex figure whose gifts were alignments at the table for the difficulty of making decision for and against the church in uncommonly difficult times. As a statesman, he could bob and weave and defer difficult decisions with the very best. Yet he always knew that duties towards God and duties towards the state are different in kind, and that eventually it may happen that we cannot see them as, we can only see them as contraries, and we have to choose. Moore knew with Augustine that our duties towards God obviously outbid our duties towards society and the state. This is clear, and the choice should follow. But not with hatred for the world, the state or society, which are non-objectionably the objects of our love. Moore is a point of light which illuminates our complex and ambiguous situation. He casts a loving shadow on our attempts to align our different loves, love of God and neighbor, love of God and love of knowledge, love of God and love of society and the state. He does this while throwing a brilliant light on the likelihood that at some time in our life, we may have to choose. A choice for us, I suppose, surely is no longer between God and King, or between Catholic and Protestant, but may very well be between the church and the secular state. The secular state is a much more amorphous reality than the King. The secular state attempts to advance tolerance, insists on human rights, and tends to be permissive regarding everything except religious convictions. It insists that religions would be respected, but only as policed by law, which is necessarily human, and with this law overriding religious judgments. The modern secular state is a gentle, non-capricious Henry, owned by no one and by all. Its reason for existence is to restrain the religious believer from, its view, the ever-present temptation to superstition and fanaticism. It does not think that religion or religious value is equal in any sort of particular way to the kind of judgment sort of that will come sort of, you know, from political expediency or from the avoidance sort of particular vices. On the side of the church, the best is not to be expected. Clearly, there'll always be tension between the church and the state, and compromise is not only inevitable, but religiously sanctioned. One can and should compromise where absolutely possible. And this is an Augustinian point. We dodge and we weave until we find we cannot. The issue that is the breaking point may differ in each of us. But we lead a charmed life if at some point, as businessmen, as lawyers, politicians, as teachers, as religious believers, we do not have to choose. For more, I think, alignment is horizontal and choice is vertical. The Christian, we, us, here, we're licensed to defer the choice in which we acknowledge that the God revealed by Christ and witnessed in the scriptures is alone worthy of our adoration and our trust. We can defer that. Part of the Catholic sensibility is we do defer that. We're not looking for a fight. We really are trying to avoid it. As Moore mounted the steps towards his execution, he could not resist one last quip to his executioner. "You may help me on my way up. I will need no help on the way down." Bravado from our jocular hero we regularly see in B-movies as a way to douse fear. The last echo of Renaissance wit who must have the last word. Probably both. Probably also someone who accepted that as with Christ, suffering is the way to glorification, and that death, however unwanted, opens the door to where all things are rectified, perhaps even the differences between Catholics and Protestants, and all things are bathed in the beauty of the light of lights. And this beauty is without fragility and does not answer to time, nor does it need to be notarized by the state. On death's door, he discovered a deep reason why he preferred comedy to tragedy. And perhaps this is what Christianity in the end amounts to. If the comedy of our life often gives way to tragedy, and that presumably is a tragedy, the Christian sees that this tragedy, this painful leave-taking, is taken up into the mercy of God and gets rewritten by the greatest author of all, as a comedy. Thank you.
Friends, we have about 10 minutes for questions.
Maybe more of a comment. Something in response, but it seems like to some degree we all go through that, not to the point of losing our life physically, but certainly losing friends and various positions and money and things like that. But at the present time, it seems like we're heading in to a particular conflict between church and state. And I don't know if you want to comment on that or not. So it certainly is relative to our present day.
No, I think it is. I think it is relative. What I did say sort of is, I suppose I said in the beginning that maybe sort of it's more nearly relevant to our culture, but it is almost impossible, I think, to separate culture sort of, you know, from political decisions and so forth. The purpose of this talk was, I think, to very generically
and very formally to, if you like, invite the analogy. There's always going to be tension sort of between Christianity and any particular social form, because it'll always sort of be an accommodation. It'd be accommodation sort of to us trying to do the best, and through which we're trying sort of to avoid sort of manifest vices, etc. I think what's interesting about Moore is that he's just there at the dawn of the secular state. We no longer have Henry. I mean, Henry is wonderful sort of, you know, for BBC insofar as every 5 years sort of we can have something sort of either about him sort of or about Anne Boleyn or Catherine sort of, you know, about Moore, about Cromwell, etc. and so forth. But in a way, sort of, it doesn't help us to understand the analogy between Moore's time and our time. I think the analogy has much more nearly got to do with we don't have any king. We don't actually, in some sense, have, let's say, the rule then of an oligarchy either stipulating how we should behave, and then we having to answer, well, we sort of will not serve in the end and become martyrs. Our situation is more complex, though you can find sort of signs of it in Moore's time. That is, that the way the state is going to interact negatively with the church or with Christianity is that the state itself, on the one hand, is a political body which makes laws and makes rules. On the other hand, it's also all of us. So the tyranny sort of is the tyranny of us against us. It's a much more difficult enemy to deal with, because it's not personal, it's impersonal, it's structural. It is, the enemy, if you like, has always breached the gate. The enemy sort of is also always ourselves. The secular state sort of is going to, if you like, be part of, shall we say, the tension within a society, insofar sort of it probably head one way and churches head another way. The problem sort of know with the state is, it's not merely a protagonist, it's also the referee. The secular state is the referee. So you could say systems get gamed. It's very easy to see a system getting gamed sort of when, of course, there are laws of the land in Elizabethan times or sort of in Tudor times. And we can get that, we know that. I mean, Moore sort of is a great jurist. The laws of the land to which sort of even the king is supposed to subscribe, until the king refuses to subscribe to them and so forth. But I think our situation is far more complex, it's far more dangerous, because it's not, we can disagree with X or Y, but we can't name the enemy, because the enemy is the air we breathe. It's the air we breathe insofar as certain kind of axioms have more or less worn out in the modern period. So let's say with respect to religion. You have to police religion, why? John Locke tells you sort of 150 years after. You have to police religion because religion sort of tends towards superstition, darkness of intellect. Darkness of intellect leads to fanaticism. Fanaticism leads sort of, you know, to religious wars. Now, I think we should actually have a moment of self-accusation sort of as religious believers, if I'm assuming that most of you are. This nebulous thing, the secular state, which is also a culture as well as a politic, would not have arisen. And this is why I spent a little time this morning talking about the way Catholics and Protestants talk to each other and dealt with each other. Would not have arisen if we had done our Christian business a lot better than we did. Right? So this, if you like, new enemy, which Moore wants to also say, don't demonize it. It's also the deliverer of goods, etc. So we have to have sort of a kind of nonpartisan spirit with respect to it. But understand that when we get into competition, we're not equal partners. We are rivals sort of in a lower degree, because sort of it's going to have the power. But also I think sort of we have to sort of bear the burden that if we have axioms that religion is going to be dangerous, and that strong beliefs, by the nature of the case, we have to take them out of public circulation. That sort of, shall we say, diktat, in a way, is a scourge of Christianity. It's a scourge of Christianity. Because the bar is set then as to sort of what sort of is going to be fanatic. That is conviction, strong convictions on X or Y, is that fanatical or not? The culture, and sometimes the politics, will decide it is. And that means that any conviction of a religious sort, whether sort of it's Christian or otherwise, is by the nature of the case forbidden. We now in the USA, we often sort of look on sort of what's happening, let's say, sort of with Islam. And we find ourselves puzzled at several respects as to how sort of, you know, how they could do the kind of things that they're doing. Now, we can no more justify jihadism than we can justify the torture or the execution of Catholics or Protestants in the 16th century. But I do think sort of we should stop being naive. What they're afraid of is, they're afraid of the West, the secular West, where the referee is a non-religious referee, and that the consequence is going to be a vast attenuation of their conviction system and the way in which sort of, way in which religion relates to the states. We sort of look back and say, well, these horrible people. Well, we were these horrible people sort of at some particular point, too. And we might also, on many occasions, like to express our opinions more vigorously and with greater conviction. In order to have the modern world that we have become attenuated as Christians and were asked to be amputated, essentially, in a way so that we've allowed our amputation. Until, of course, we say enough is enough. But I think if we look, let's say, at something which is strange to us, we will see sort of what our problem is. Not really do they fear, and then we sort of can offer a kind of consolation and so forth, but actually that they have every right to fear us. Islam will not be the same Islam. We know it has historically changed, and this is probably the most sort of aggressive form we've seen sort of in history. So there's better forms, but still, no matter what, it's very difficult for Islam to be Islam in the modern world. And they're sort of taking the option, well, if there isn't a better understanding, fundamentally better respect for religion, we will not serve. We will not come in. So I think one of the things that has to happen sort of in first world countries is not just simply that by way of commanding the peace you give sort of rights but also obligations sort of to those people who are sort of non-Christians sort of, and so forth. You actually have to understand more nearly, respect them more nearly, that they're going to have convictions sort of which are much stronger convictions than sort of for the most part sort of Europeans and North Americans are going to have sort of an X, Y, and Z issue. That's probably an overlong answer, but that would be the answer.
You mentioned that part of the difficulty that we have today is because we really paved the way for it. I think it's an extraordinarily important point that I heard you say. And I can't help but think of what Pope Benedict said when he was giving a papal audience on St. Francis of Assisi, the exact same point, that you have to look at the church at the time of Francis of Assisi, how the church had grown cold, what the behavior of the clergy was, what was going on, and that paved the way for the Reformation that came after. So my question is, would you care to make a linkage between what Thomas More was doing, consequences of that earlier time, and then what Pope, looking ahead to what Pope Benedict saw very much with in a Thomas More manner, I think.
Yeah. Right. One of the main things this morning, I think, is that I want all of us to leave here sort of with the notion that Thomas More was extraordinarily complicated, was not perfect, exemplary but not perfect. A light so because everything he did sort of is a kind of magnification sort of our own strengths and our own weaknesses. So here's how I'm going to answer the point here. I think in many respects, More sort of standing up sort of for, in the last instance, even if sort of we make sort of accommodations, we make intellectual accommodations. More sort of was a great learned Renaissance figure. So it's very important for him that being religious does not mean being unintellectual. Being religious does not mean unscientific. Being religious does not mean so that we should not make social progress. Being religious does not mean so that we should not sort of try to keep our political sort of business, and that we should not sort of somehow or rather sort of have a sense as to and a continued reflection on our moral obligations. All those things are there. This is not scripture alone. This is not Christianity in a sectarian mode. All of that sort of is there. Clearly, sort of, we have over the centuries failed with respect to that, failed with respect to being open to science, being neurology, being too nervous, and so forth. More gives us, I think, you don't have to be afraid. You only have contradiction when it's in your face. Assume and trust that there's no sort of fundamental contradiction sort of between the deliverances of reason and deliverances of faith. That's the good part. That's a good part of the story. Moore himself, probably three quarters a Renaissance figure, the writer in Utopia, the great pleader for religious tolerance in Utopia. The Utopia, that is, that which is not in history, would be a place of maximal religious tolerance. He's thinking that through philosophically, he's thinking that through religiously. Moore. So if we go down that line, then Moore is a prophet against religious extremism insofar as religion, not morality, religion should in and of itself have such intrinsic power to put the brakes on violence. We would expect religion, Christianity, to police itself. And we would hope to the degree to which we are Christians that we can find that in the gospel and that we can find that sort of in the theological tradition. That, I think, is a mandate. Go find it. If it is the case that it's found outside the church, well, woe is we. My assumption is that we can find it. But here's the point with respect to Moore. Moore found it and also lost it somewhat. The best of us can fail. I hope to have indicated he may very well be the best of us, but not only did he negotiate and did not have clean hands in that way, he negotiated sort of with bloody hands. Not in the way sort of he's been excoriated recently, but nonetheless, he did not fully transcend sort of, you know, the trauma, the literal trauma of the time. Remember, as I'm giving these lists as to what the debates are between Catholics and Protestants, I hope you found this somewhat heavy, and because if you had any one of those in previous times in history, that would have been relatively theologically traumatic. But in this instance, you've got everything at stake. And second of all, so if you've got sort of a, you know, particular groups and political powers, in which there's a sense in which everyone is designating everyone else as a heretic. Luther has designated all of Catholicism as heretical because it was not biblical. And then, sort of, then of course, the reaction response to that is the designation of Luther so as a heretic and every other Protestant as a heretic. And then we have this sort of too close an arrangement between the political order and the religion, which is going to win out. So whichever one seems to be winning out at that particular point, if that particular group can name another group heretical, there isn't enough separation sort of, between political power sort of, and religion, therefore that person is treasonable. Therefore, they can't sort of be executed. So I think Moore rises above everything, and Moore also is a sense of our fragility, the way in which the best of us can be caught up sort of, you know, in periods, and the way the best of us sort of can give in sort of, you know, to precisely what later on would be capitalized sort of, you know, by the secularists. Well, look, the best of Catholics weren't able to rise above it. The best of them weren't able to rise above it. We could have and we should have not a plastic figure, a sinner, and this sort of note is kind of one sort of note of the inflection sort of note of sin in his life.
So friends, we've come to the end of the hour, and therefore we have to call it quits. But before we do, we have one remaining responsibility, that's to thank our speaker. I have a little gift I'd like to present our speaker. I have to say this is a little bit self-serving. But it is an Advent calendar. It's an Advent calendar that the Institute for Church Life has made, and it's on sale in the bookstore. We're giving you one for free. Friends, we'll be back on September 19th when Kathy Hilkert, who is professor of systematic theology here as well, is going to talk about Catherine of Siena as woman of the world. It is silence that kills the world. We'll see you then. Thank you.